Good morning.
Good morning.
Welcome to First Presbyterian Church on this second Sunday of Easter. Christ is risen.
He is risen indeed.
He is risen indeed. Thankfully, Easter is not just one day in the church. It is a 50-day season, which means it's 10 days longer than Lent. So all the reflection and going into those sad places during Lent, we get 10 more days of brightness and joy and all of that. So welcome to worship on this second Sunday of Easter. We celebrate the resurrection as we do every Sunday, but especially in this season, and the resurrection's power to bring renewal to all of creation, which we will talk more about today. As we begin our worship, we start every week with our mission statement, which is a way to remind ourselves of who we are as we gather in worship. So would you please join me in reciting our mission statement? We are a Christian family of faith empowered by the Holy Spirit to glorify God, to proclaim His word, and to grow together in Christ. I invite you now to stand for our musical call to worship. Creator God, today we turn to your word that demonstrates the abundance of your creation. Holy Spirit, give us eyes to see you and ears to hear, and give us the hope of Christ's resurrection, which makes all things new in heaven and on earth. Amen.
Thank you. be seated. God, who blesses us abundantly, who gives us so much, also promises us grace and love. Let us trust in the mercy of our Creator as we make our confession. Please join me in our prayer of corporate confession found in your bulletin and also displayed behind me. Holy God, giver of blessings, we thank you for the mercies we know and ask your forgiveness when we neglect to acknowledge you as the source of all good. When we hoard your gifts, when we say, that's mine, when we ignore the bounty around us, when we are blind to good, forgive us. Help us to share, to see, to live gratefully. Through Christ we pray. And now in our silence, please hear our personal confessions. Hear the good news. God provides abundantly, abundant life, abundant grace, abundant love. In the name of Jesus Christ, we are forgiven. Thanks be to God. Since God has forgiven us in Christ, let us forgive one another. The peace of our Lord Jesus Christ be with you all, and also with you. Won't you please rise and greet your neighbor?
Oh, my microphone is on. Oh, there we go. I left my microphone on during that hymn. That's not good for anyone. Okay, so friends, come on in, take a seat. So last weekend, all of these folks, except for one, which you will find out, came with us, or not with me, I didn't go, but came with our church to Camp Berea, and we wanted to hear a little bit about how it was. So friends, would you mind first introducing yourselves, and then I've got some questions for you.
My name is Rob Buchholz. This is my son, Harrison.
Hi.
I'm Lindsay Buchholz, and this is our daughter,
Claire Buchholz.
Claire, wonderful. So, three out of four of you went to Camp Berea, which I assume means one of you had a lovely weekend at home by herself. Rob, Harrison, Claire, let me ask you all, did you find anything, were there any highlights that you want to share with us about going to camp?
Learning, more about God. And hanging out with all my friends.
Learning about God and hanging out with friends.
And singing and dancing.
And singing and dancing. I mean, these are a few of my favorite things, right? Any Sound of Music fans? No? Okay. Other highlights?
Going tubing and doing dancing.
Going tubing, yes, absolutely. And dancing. Rob, how about you?
I think one of the highlights for me was when we did the game where we were on one side and the other team was on the other side. And it was, do you remember what I was talking about? Remember when we played with the little slingshot things? Was there a picture up there? No, that's Harrison. We were on two sides of the gym and there was a blue team and a red team and we competed as teams in an activity. And somehow I was volunteered to be I went one-on-one with the other person from the other team. And after an exhausting 10-minute battle, pulled it out. So that was exciting. Yeah.
Yes. Representing our
that's
church.
Right, that's
yes.
Right, that's right.
Victory. Wonderful. What were some things that surprised you this last weekend? Any surprises from what you were expecting? Maybe?
I was surprised by how much I enjoyed the music.
Okay, cool. Yeah.
I'm still sort of figuring out how I express my faith, but okay. I definitely connected with the music, and I thought that was pretty cool. It was this guy by Phil Wickham, and we were still listening to this song, House of the Lord, at home. Yeah,
cool.
We really dig it, so that was really cool.
Yeah, music is such a good way to express our faith, indeed.
I went tubing, and I hurt my tailbone, so that was surprising.
That was surprising?
So I didn't get to really compete in like the slingshot game, which made me sad.
Okay.
We learned about like harmony.
Okay.
And which is like when you bring two good things together, you make one like great thing.
Ooh, that's good. Bringing a few things together, making one thing great. Very good. Cool. Lindsay, how about for you? Kids and Rob being away, coming back home, did you see any changes in them or any surprises for you?
I think it's always nice once in a while to kind of have, you know, felt like a reset for them. Cool. Aside from the religious component to it, I think it's no surprise that our kids nowadays are also like on electronics like all the time. And it's kind of like a battle, right? Setting boundaries, but then sort of like struggling with that. And so I definitely saw a difference when they came back. It's just like, you know, having a reset, recalibration, and they were so excited to tell me about it and to share with me everything they learned. And I definitely saw a difference in them. They were very excited to share that with me. And I think it's a good recalibration. They're obviously out in, you know, nature, and they're exercising, and they're singing, they're dancing, and they really enjoyed the whole weekend. So, and then Harrison has something to share, because coincidentally, I heard that the theme of the weekend was harmony.
Okay.
And then coincidentally, when Harrison went to school Monday morning after the weekend, he went to music class. And what did your teacher ask you?
The first thing she told me is, what does harmony mean?
Oh, okay.
So Harrison shot his hand up.
Yes.
He said, I know the answer. What did you tell her?
Two good things to make one great thing.
Awesome. Yeah, and what'd she say?
That's correct.
Yes, amen. Very cool. Well, friends, thank you so much for sharing about your experience that this last weekend going to Camp Berea with friends and tubing and great music and lots of fun and connecting with God and one another. So, friends, can we thank them for sharing? Thank you all. Yeah. Now we've got our special music from the children's choir. Kids, you are now invited to head to Sunday school. We will see you later on in the service. Have fun, everyone. Okay, so a few announcements from the life of the church. Today being the first Sunday, being Communion Sunday, our loose offering. So any cash coins that goes into the plates today will go to the Deacon's Fund. So please think and pray about that as the offering happens. We also have a tradition that we probably don't announce enough, but I want to make sure everyone remembers too that in our partnership with Interfaith Social Services, we try to bring food items and other health items to donate to Interfaith Social Services on the first Sunday of the month. So please remember that. The first Sunday of May would be next. Kids Fun is happening today, so is Youth Group. So kids, families, stick around after church and we'll have some good fun. There is no children's choir rehearsal for the next two Thursdays. Next week, Wednesdays. The adult choir does Thursday. Yeah. No. Y'all don't have the week off. Just the kids choir. Sorry, Wednesdays. So no kids choir rehearsals for the next 2 weeks, April 10th and 17th. On Tuesday, I'm flying to North Carolina for a conference, so I'll be out of town for Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, and I will see you all back on Sunday. We have an Inquirers class beginning April 21st. This is a class, a gathering for anyone interested in either joining the church formally as a member or for anyone who just has questions about who we are. This could include anyone who's actually a member. You may have joined 40 years ago and you might be thinking, well, I haven't done this in a long time. Why don't I just join again? So if you are interested in lunch and a good time with good friends, I invite you to come to the Inquirers class. But it is certainly especially for people inquiring, that's why we call it this, having any questions about what it means to be a part of this church family, to understand our history, not just of this congregation, but of our faith and our denomination and all of that. What does it mean to be in a denomination? And what does it mean to be a Presbyterian? What does it mean to enjoy eating lunch with other people? If you want an answer to any of those questions, come to our Inquirers class. It'll be after church, Sundays, April 21st, 28th, and then the first two Sundays of May as well. And if you miss any of those weeks, that's fine. We will have plenty of opportunities to make that up. Let's see. We have requests from our mission partners, the Forgotten Initiative, that there are some local teenage girls who are in need of some stuff. And so we've got an Amazon link in our Thursday email to help provide them some of those things. This includes things like MP3 players, stuffed animals, stuff like that. I believe that is all for the announcements. And so now we have our first reading from Scripture.
First problem solved. Good morning, everybody. Today we're going to take a look at Matthew, and you can find this on the New Testament, page 6. And this will be Matthew 6, 25 to 30. Therefore, I tell you, do not worry about life, what you will eat or what you will drink, or about your body, what you will wear. Is not life more than food, and the body more than clothing? Look at the birds in the air. They never sow, nor reap, nor gather into barns, and yet your heavenly Father feeds them. Are you not more of value than they? And can you add by worrying a single hour to your span of life? And why do you worry about clothing? Consider the lilies of the field and how they grow. They neither toil nor spin, yet I tell you, even Solomon, in all of his glory, was not clothed like one of these. But if God so clothes the grass of the field, which is alive today and tomorrow is thrown into the oven, will he not much more clothe you, you of little faith? This ends the reading, and may God bless these words.
Our second reading is from Genesis 1, verses 20 through chapter 1, verse 2. Genesis 1, 20 to 2, 1. So after 4 days of creation, Genesis 1:20 says this. And God said, "Let the waters bring forth swarms of living creatures, and let birds fly above the earth across the dome of the sky." So God created the great sea monsters and every living creature that moves of every kind with which the waters swarm, and every winged bird of every kind. And God saw that it was good. God blessed them, saying, "Be fruitful and multiply and fill the waters in the sea and let the birds multiply on the earth." And there was evening and there was morning, the fifth day. And God said, "Let the earth bring forth living creatures of every kind, cattle and creeping things and wild animals of the earth of every kind." And it was so. God made the wild animals of the earth of every kind and the cattle of every kind and everything that creeps upon the ground of every kind. And God saw that it was good. Then God said, "Let us make humankind in our image, according to our likeness, and let them have dominion over the fish of the sea, and over the birds of the air, and over the cattle, and over all the wild animals of the earth, and over every creeping thing that creeps upon the earth." So God created humankind in his image. In the image of God, he created them. Male and female, he created them. And God blessed them. And God said to them, "Be fruitful and multiply and fill the earth and subdue it and have dominion over the fish of the sea and over the birds of the air and over every living thing that moves upon the earth." God said, "See, I have given you every plant yielding seed that is upon the face of the earth, and every tree with fruit in its with seed in its fruit. You shall have them for food. And to every beast of the earth and to every bird of the air, and to everything that creeps on the earth, everything that has the breath of life, I've given every green plant for food." And it was so. And God saw everything that he had made, and indeed it was very good. And there was evening, and there was morning, the sixth day. Thus the heavens and the earth were finished, and all their multitude. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Today we begin a new sermon series on caring for creation. April is Earth Month, and Earth Day is April 22nd. This sermon series will focus on a branch of stewardship that we often mention, but don't necessarily dive deeply into very often. So today, for today's sermon, I want to begin with our mindset, what we are mindful of. If we are mindful of the abundance with which God created the earth, we will want to act in a way that cares for this abundance. For too long, humanity has seen the earth with a scarcity mindset, that the earth is a resource to be used up quicker than the competition. But abundance, not scarcity, is how creation is described in Scripture, which we will explore today and throughout this month. To be abundant means existing or available in large quantities or plentiful. It's when there's a whole lot of something, and God created a whole lot of stuff. And abundance is elsewhere in Scripture as well to describe God's faithfulness and love. 2 Corinthians 9:8 God is able to provide you with every blessing in abundance, so that by always having enough of everything, you may share abundantly in every good work. In John 10:10, Jesus says, "I came that you may have life and have it abundantly." And Exodus 34:6 describes God like this: the Lord, a God merciful and gracious, slow to anger and abounding in steadfast love and faithfulness." Our God is a God of abundance, abundant life, abundant love, abundant grace and forgiveness. And enjoying nature, as Lindsay shared about her kids going to Camp Berea, enjoying nature is one of the best ways to experience God's abundance in creation. So I've thought of a few ways that I've seen abundance as I have enjoyed creation. So I want to give you a few examples. Many of these, if you've been here every Sunday since I've been here, you'll probably roll your eyes at, because I talk about these things all the time because I enjoy them so much. But if you're new, they'll be exciting for you. I've shared before that when I was an undergrad in college, I was fortunate enough to have a job in college as an undergrad assistant at our marine biology lab. And so this included a lot of lab work, which was a little more boring, but the best roles were out in the field. I got to drive the boat to collect water samples and plankton samples, and on the best days we would go scuba diving off the rocky reefs off of the peninsula of Palos Verdes in Los Angeles. And in these kelp forests, there was an abundance of life, and it was not just seen in the sheer number of fish and plant species that you saw, but also in the diversity of the number of those species that you witnessed. I'll stop talking about kelp. In 2013, I was fortunate enough to lead a group of students on a short-term mission trip to Kenya. And after serving in two orphanages for a couple weeks and learning in those places, we closed our trip with a two-day safari in the Masai Mara National Reserve. Now, this reserve is famous for something called the Great Migration, where over a million wildebeest from the south travel through and into the Masai Mara, usually beginning around late July. Unfortunately, we were there in early July, so we didn't get to see that. But the amount of life was still awe-inspiring. I can best characterize it, the abundance of the life by how quickly we got used to being there. So we landed on this airstrip, and we drove about half an hour to our camp. And on the way, we saw zebras and gazelle and wildebeest and warthogs, things you only see in a zoo with fences around them, but here they were in their natural habitat with nothing hindering them the way they've been living for millions of years. And 2 days later, on our way back to that airstrip, it was kind of like, "Oh, there's another zebra. There's a warthog." That sounds so silly, but it was like we were so spoiled in those 2 days by the abundance of life that we saw that after 2 days, these amazing things seemed normal to us. Last one. A couple months ago, Cassie and I went scuba diving in Thailand on our trip at this pinnacle called Sail Rock. It's this rock that just juts out of the middle of the ocean out of kind of nowhere. And there, like in Palos Verdes, the diversity of life was amazing, but here it was the vastness of the schools of fish that gather around this pinnacle where all these nutrients well up from the depths of the ocean. Schools of barracuda and trevally and squirrelfish and batfish, and if I name any more, you'll probably think I'm making these up. But they swarm around this area to a point where if you swim through one, which we did, we got to swim through a school of trevally, there was a point where you could see nothing but fish. And I looked up and down, and it started to become a little disorienting. But such a unique experience. Now, each of these examples, enjoying the abundance of God's creation, these are all really far away places. But here in Quincy, here in the South Shore, we don't have to go far to enjoy the natural world. We have beaches and parks and reserves where you can see dense forests and sea life. I hike regularly in the Blue Hills to reconnect with God's creation, as I'm usually surrounded by human creation. Jesus invites us in the first reading to consider the lilies, to consider the birds of the air as lessons of God's goodness and provision for us. It doesn't take much for us to go and consider some flowers or look at the birds. For many of us, all we have to do is walk out the door and we can start. Now, in Genesis 1, the Bible starts with abundance. God creates abundantly in Genesis 1. Walter Brueggemann, an Old Testament professor, says, it tells us how well, Genesis 1, tells us how well the world is ordered. It declares that God blesses, that is, endows with vitality, the plants and the animals and the fish and the birds and humankind. When we read Genesis 1, it's important to read it within the genre that it is, poetry. This was a poem God gave the Israelites to describe God's power and sovereignty, to describe the world around them, to describe humanity's relationship with God and with the rest of creation. It's not meant to be read as a science textbook, but as a poem. And so as poetry, let's look at the words on the page, but let's also look past the words on the page to the larger meaning behind them. So there were 6 days of creation through this rhythm, and then a 7th day of rest. And the first 3 days of creation kind of set the stage for the rest of creation. And I use that word literally, that God kind of set up the props and the stage and the lighting and all of that so that, like a crew does for acting, like God was setting everything up for the next 3 days to fill that stage with life. And the beautiful kind of poetic thing is that the first day's stage setting is then filled by day 4, and then The first day sets the stage for everything that happens on day 4. Okay. The second day sets the stage for everything that comes into being on day 5, and the third day sets the stage for everything that comes into being on day 6. Okay, do we see the kind of the symmetry here? Okay, so I'll describe it. God creates light in the midst of darkness on day 1, and the light is called day, and the dark is called night. On day 4, God fills the light and dark with heavenly bodies, the sun and the moon, in order to keep time, rhythm, hours, days, seasons, and years. Day 2, God creates the sky and the sea. Day 5, God creates birds and fish. You see where I'm going here? Okay. Day 3, God creates dry land and vegetation. And day 6, God fills the dry land with creatures, including human beings. When God fills the stage, when God endows the earth with life, God does so abundantly, and God looks at it and says, it is very good. Life is everywhere. But God doesn't stop on that one act of creation. He looks at each living part of creation, and God says, be fruitful and multiply. Fill the earth with even more abundance. When we read a poem like this, it's clear that God cares not just for people, but for every part of creation. And it's clear that it is good, yet it is only when everything is created all together and working in harmony, as we talked about, the many things working for one greater thing, it's at that point when God says it is very good. And yet the poem has this kind of clear breaking point, a clear point of focus, when it describes the creation of human beings. So human beings in this poem are kind of set apart. And here's what it says. God said, let us make humankind in our image. So that's the first unique thing. According to our likeness. And let them have dominion over the fish of the sea and over the birds of the air, etc., etc. So God created humankind in his image. In the image of God, he created them. Male and female, he created them. And God blessed them and said, be fruitful and multiply just like to the other animals. But then God said, fill the earth and subdue it. Have dominion over the fish and sea of the sea, etc., etc. In the Greek translation of the Hebrew Bible, which is called the Septuagint, the word they use for image when it says we were created in the image of God is where we get the word icon. And an icon in the ancient world, these were used to demonstrate a person's likeness in a place where they could not be. So classically, especially in the time of Rome, for example, Caesars created images of themselves. They set icons in every city that they conquered so that even when they were not in that city, the people had a reminder of who had dominion over them through this icon. The Orthodox Church, the Eastern Orthodox Church, continues to use icons for images of how to imagine Jesus and the Trinity and the Virgin Mary, etc. And so when we are created in the image of God, we are like icons of God, that we are reminders of who God is and what God does wherever we are placed. When you look at your life, how you live and love and speak, do people see a reminder of who God is? Are you a God icon? Are you bearing God's image responsibly? Now that's the Greek word. The Hebrew word is the word called tselem, which is a play on the Hebrew word for shadow. A shadow acts exactly as that which casts the shadow, except for in Peter Pan. We're going to ignore Peter Pan for now. A shadow acts exactly as that which casts the shadow. And so we are shadows of God in a way. So do we act as shadows of God, as tselem, moving and loving as God moves and loves through the earth? Being created in the image of God is a wonderful privilege. It is also a responsibility. We are called to demonstrate God's likeness to others, including to all of creation, in our call to have dominion over creation. And this domination is not a domination or a form like that. Dominion in this term is like the way a king has dominion over his kingdom or a shepherd over his flock. God created us in the image of God to delegate the care for creation. We are called to do God's work on earth as his icons, to make us shepherds, to move so in step with God through creation that we are like shadows, to care for the staging of days 1 through 3, and to care for that which fills the stage with life in days 4 through 6. God creates each creature to be fruitful and to multiply, to thrive. God calls us to have dominion over all the creatures, not as a call to exploit creation, but to oversee and enable its thriving. So will we recognize and even confess the ways that we have impeded the thriving of creation? When we read and focus on the abundance of God's creation in Genesis 1, we will recognize that the earth belongs to God, and its abundance is vital to the thriving of every living thing, every form of life that God created. When we see a world of abundance, we will tap into what that Professor Brueggemann calls the overflowing goodness that pours from God's creator spirit. But when we view the world through a lens of scarcity, we will cause injustice. We fight over scarce land and resources. We hoard so that we have more and others have less. We see the world not as a stage for the abundance of life to thrive, but as a deposit of finite resources for us to collect and use up. To be a disciple of Jesus is to recognize the vastness and beauty of our Creator's world, and to claim that responsibility of God's image bearers, who should celebrate and protect creation's abundance rather than diminish it. So as we continue in this series, keep that word in mind, abundant. God works out of abundance, not scarcity. Amen.
Thank you.
Will you please join me in prayer? We thank you, Creator, for making this beautiful world that we love, for flowers that bloom, for crows that squawk, for the sky full of clouds. You made women and men and children the people that we love and depend on and admire. You made all this out of love, and we give you our thanks and praise. We ask for your help as we tend to your creation. We ask for your guidance in being neighbors to your children, in being keepers of your creatures, in caring for the trees and water and air that you made for us. In awe and wonder, with appreciation for the responsibility given to us, we offer ourselves as your partners in the great garden of this world. And as your partners, we also accept and appreciate our responsibility to pray for others. Today we pray for all those on our prayer list, for Andrew, Christian, Bob, Rita, Godswill, Les, and Marge, as well as the family of Deborah. Lord, bless and keep all these siblings in Christ. Bring them healing and wholeness, just as you promise healing and wholeness for all your creation through the resurrection of Jesus, our Lord, in whose name we pray. Amen.
The person who sows sparingly will also reap sparingly, and the person who sows generously will also reap generously. Each person should do as he or she has decided in their heart, not reluctantly or out of necessity, for God loves a cheerful giver. And God is able to make every grace overflow to you, so that in every way, always having everything you need, you may excel in every good work. 2 Corinthians 9, 6 through 8. Will the ushers please come forward?
Jesus, Christ, be healed. Oh, you say I am.
Lord, please take these gifts that we have given and let them multiply abundantly so that we may serve not only our church family members, but also the surrounding areas. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
And please stay standing for this morning's affirmation of faith as we confess our faith together using the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth on the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. You may be seated. It's out of God's abundance that we are invited to this table, to participate in this meal, not only as individuals in our relationship with God, but also as a church body, as a family. Jesus invites us to this table, as I said, out of an abundance of love, but it is through sacrifice that he shows that love. Jesus invites us to this table to remember that sacrifice and to remember the hope that we have that after that sacrifice, resurrection came, that even death does not separate us from the love that we have from God in Jesus Christ. This table, this meal, our fellowship, our worship, it all reminds us of that truth. Will you join me in prayer? Praise to you, O God, for all your works. You created the world with abundance and called it good. You made us in your image, your tselem, to live together in love. You made a covenant with us, and even when we turned from you, you remained ever faithful. Thank you, O God, for sending us your Son. He lived among us and told your story. He taught us to pray to you. He healed the sick and welcomed sinners. He shared our pain and died our death, then rose to new life that we might live and all creation be restored. Remembering your abundant love revealed to us in Jesus Christ, we break bread and share the cup, giving ourselves to you to live for him in joy and praise. Gracious God, pour out your Holy Spirit upon us and upon these gifts of bread and wine, that they may be for us the body and blood of Christ, and that we may be his body for the world. By your Spirit, unite us with Christ and one another until we feast with him and with all your saints in the eternal realm of justice and peace. Through Christ, with Christ, in Christ, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor are yours, Almighty God, now and forever. And as our Savior Christ taught us, we are now bold to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, the glory forever. Amen. On the night he was betrayed, Jesus took bread, and after giving thanks for it, he broke it. And he He gave it to his disciples. And he said, take, eat. This is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. Body of Christ given for you. After the meal, Jesus took the cup and said, "This cup is the new covenant sealed in my blood, poured out for you for the forgiveness of sins. Every time you drink this cup, do this in remembrance of me." The blood of Christ given for you. Every time you eat this bread and drink from this cup, you proclaim Christ's redeeming love until until he returns. Will you join me in prayer? God of abundance, with this bread of life and cup of salvation, you have united us with Christ, making us one with all your people. Now send us forth in the power of your Spirit, that we may proclaim your redeeming love to the world and continue forever in the risen life of Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. And now I don't hear any kids, so we will have our moment for children after our closing hymn. Seated. Friends, welcome back into the sanctuary. Let me get a path down here before it gets closed up. Oh, hold on one sec. Let me squeeze through here. Like the Red Sea? Okay. Friends, how are we doing? What did we do downstairs? Yeah, Allie. You made a video?
Yeah.
And a poster? That's so cool. I've never made a video. But you made about ways to conserve water and save water and ways that we could kind of partner with God in caring for God's creation. How cool. Yeah. Played Foursquare. Awesome. One of my favorite games, personally. I play it all the time. I don't have three friends, so I can't play. But I'm just joking. What else? Anything else? What else did we do? Yeah. The name game. Okay, what's the name game? You say your name really fast, three times, and then you name an animal that starts with the same letter as your name. So, Alistair, which animal did you choose? Alligator, that's what I thought you would do. I think I would do... Dragonfly. Ah, a DR also. Anything else? Anything else we learned or did? I see some things you colored, yeah? Using a broom instead of a hose to clean off your driveway. Amen. Yes, that's a great way to conserve water. Yeah, last
when
thing.
When you're like brushing your teeth, you turn off the sink so it's not like running.
When you're brushing your teeth, turn off the water while you're brushing so it's not consistently running. Absolutely, yeah. Use a refillable water bottle. Oh my gosh. Okay, how many more ways can we conserve water? This is wonderful. Yes. Take shorter showers. Yeah, cool. If you waste too much water, that's a bad thing. Absolutely. Okay, friends, unfortunately, I'm going to cut it off there because there are so many ways we can save water, but it's time for coffee hour. Here's what I want you to do. Here's what I want you to do. I want you to remember all of those ways to conserve, and then we will do the benediction. Let's pray. Dear God, thank you for the world you created, and thank you for creating me. Thank you for your love. In Jesus' name. Amen. Friends, you may go sit with your families. And everyone, I'll invite you to stand and receive the charge and benediction. Of course, you can stay with me. Yes. Come on up here. Okay. Friends, remember the abundance with which God created. And remember that love, grace, forgiveness, etc., 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 all of it that God gives to you, God does so in abundance. Now receive this blessing from Ephesians 3:20. Now to him who by the power at work within us is able to accomplish abundantly far more than we all can ask or imagine, to him be glory in the church and in Christ Jesus to all generations, forever and ever.